now on Islam Channel, Living the Life.
Living the life. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to Living the Life this evening with Asif Malik.
Yes, and Atif Nawaz. Welcome to tonight's show. And we have a great show for you lined up with a great mix of guests who are holding events this week. So let's get involved so you can take your pick where you want to go. We also have international stories from around the world, so make sure you stick around.
Most definitely. Now, our first pair of guests will be telling us about their upcoming events this weekend. We're also going to be joined by brothers from a very inspirational initiative and some brothers who will be part of a very special awards event as well. So loads of event stuff going on today, inshallah.
Looking forward to that. But before we find out more from our guests in the green room, we have our story of the day.
Amazing.
700 French skiers came together to form a heart so that a picture could be taken all the way from space. Yes.
Wow.
French astronaut Thomas Pesquet was taking a picture from the International Space Station. That is unbelievable.
That's
isn't
a lot
it?
Of people.
Look at that
I mean,
there.
I just feel like, I mean, that's very cute and everything, but do we need a picture from space of people making a heart?
Was that the, is it the French house that they're in?
I guess so, but like they're all together and they're kind of making a physical human heart, right? Like, so they're drawing the heart, so looking from a bird's eye view, it'd look like a heart. It's just, I don't know, man. It seems like they could have done something better with this Saturday for me.
Going all the way into space to take a picture of a heart.
Take your family out for a biryani or something. I don't know.
Maybe
but I mean, that looks good.
Bit of Matiai, maybe Ambala.
Well, there's so many options, but they decided to do this. Well, it's cool. I guess it's quite cool that you could see it from space. But if you're in space, I imagine you'd want, you know, I don't know if it's going to blow your mind. Is it? Okay, I admit that looks really, really cool. That does look quite cool.
It does look nice. But the snow's melting.
The snow is melting, isn't it? It's all going dark snow.
Oh, that's quite nice.
Yeah.
It looks pretty.
Yeah, I take back a little bit of what I said, but I still think people have too much time on their hands these days.
Anyway, where do people get these ideas from?
Where do they? All they want is to look good on Instagram. That's all it is, I'm telling you. Anyway, let's move on to welcome our guests who are now in the green room. Please welcome, what an array of guests we have. Abdullah Khan, Ishaq Jassad, Shahul Hamid Dawood, Usman Moon, and Jamal Manan. Assalamu alaikum, guys.
Wow,
it's like the Jamaat after my Tarabi prayers over there. It's amazing. This is incredible.
Like Jamaat.
It really is. Assalamu alaikum, guys. Welcome to the show. Let's start with Ishaq Jassad and Jamal Manan. Assalamu alaikum, guys. Great to have you on the show. Are you both well?
Alhamdulillah, bin salam. Jazakallah for having us. Alhamdulillah, we're both well.
Now, you guys are behind the National Huffadh Association of the UK. Tell us a little bit about what that is.
So basically, we're an international national organisation. We came together last year purely to meet the needs of those youngsters and elder generation who have memorised the Quran and basically trying to secure Tarawih placements. It's quite a niche organisation. We felt it was something that was in demand as there's so many Huffadhs around the UK, and we've had a phenomenal response. We've had over 1,000 people register with us, and we're working with quite a few organisations, not just in the UK but abroad as well.
Fantastic. Great organisation.
Oh, fantastic. Brilliant. Keep up good work. And Abdullah Khan and Usman, welcome.
Hello, assalamu alaikum.
Alaikum assalam.
Good. Please do tell us about an up-and-coming event and the organisation you're involved in now.
Dawah Project, which is part of Islam Channel, spreading Islam through the media, will be having fun events this weekend on Saturday. Firstly, a marriage event, and then there's a Tiba Foundation charity dinner in the evening, inshallah.
Fantastic.
Marriage event. We like that.
Yes.
Tune in.
That's good. I'm sure there's a lot of people, a lot of brothers in the community who are looking to get married. And sisters, of course. They can get themselves that. We'll find out more about that as well. And, of course, we have Shahul with us as well. Shahul, you are part of a very interesting, very dynamic awards ceremony. Give us a little indication what that's about.
Assalamu alaikum, brothers.
Walaikum salam.
Thank you so much for giving us the opportunity. We come all the way from Malaysia.
MashaAllah.
Welcome.
Well, the awards is one of the very interesting program which has been happening for the past 6 years in Dubai. And this is the first year we have brought this to London. We have close to 250 of our guests coming from 10 countries. Inshallah, it'll be a great show tomorrow. It'll be a very good opportunity for people around UK to do a lot of business networking, exchanging their business programs, promoting their products and sectors. So I think it's going to be a very exciting night tomorrow.
It sounds it, yeah, for sure. Well, it really does.
Is that the Middle East Business Leaders Summit Awards?
Yeah, absolutely. That's the Middle East Business Leadership Awards.
Fantastic. Yeah. Well, listen, we're going to find out more about that. We're going to find out more about the Thiba Foundation and the Dawah Project event, and we're going to find out more about the National Huffadh. There's so much to talk about, guys. Can't wait to have you on the main sofa very shortly. But before we welcome our first guest to the main sofa, we're off for a story in Mongolia.
Mongolia!
Now, herders could face losing their livestock due to bad weather conditions currently gripping the country. An international emergency appeal has been launched to help. Let's take a look.
Thousands of Mongolian herders face disastrous livestock losses from dreaded severe weather known as the Zod, the Red Cross said Thursday in launching an international aid appeal. Landlocked Mongolia is grappling for the second straight year with losses from Zod conditions, a dry summer followed by bitter winter cold that leaves livestock and other animals at risk of starvation and exposure on the country's rugged steppes. It threatens tens of thousands of herders in a country where almost half the population depends entirely on livestock for food, transportation and income, the International Federation of Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies said. Cattle, sheep and other animals usually die en masse in the Zod, weakened by insufficient summer grazing that prevents them building up the fat reserves necessary to withstand winter temperatures, which can plummet as low as minus 50 degrees Celsius. As of early February, more than 42,546 livestock animals had already perished in the current Zod, the statement said, citing official Mongolian figures.
So far, animal loss is not that high, but still, we don't know what will come during the spring, because all worst impacts are very clear during the March, April and May, and then still, there are a lot of the troubles and the challenges to get over.
It added that more than 157,000 people are at risk across 17 of Mongolia's 21 provinces. The relief organization hopes to raise enough to assist 11,000 of the hardest hit households, including provision of cash grants, first aid kits, and funds to help communities prepare for future Zods. The Zod strikes the country every few years. Thousands of Mongolian households lead a nomadic existence as herders amid Mongolia's vast plains and mountains, and recurring Zod conditions are blamed for forcing many into a marginalized urban sector in Ulaanbaatar.
It's very sad.
That's amazing, isn't it?
It really is. Well, inshallah, you know, things will get easy. May Allah make it easier for those guys in Mongolia.
Ameen.
Absolutely.
Now, so anyway, yes, definitely. Now, please, please welcome our special guests that have just come into the into our room.
That's right.
So welcome. Our first guests in the show are from the Thiba Foundation and the Dawah Project, two fantastic charities making a difference in the Muslim community. They have two up-and-coming events this weekend and will be bringing the community together and will strengthen the bonds and understanding between people.
That's right. Now, here to tell us more, please welcome Abdullah Khan and Usman Moon. Asalaamu Alaikum, guys.
Wa Alaikum Asalaam.
Welcome to the show. Once again, it's lovely to have you guys. And thank you for making an effort and dressing up. That's always appreciated, you know. It's always nice when somebody comes to see you.
It's always nice to look at the studio from the outside, but we are here today.
We're going to try and compete with you guys.
So. Well, there's no competition, brother. Mashallah, you are winning all the awards today. Listen, we talked a little bit about this recently, but let's catch up on it a little bit. Thiba Foundation, what is it all about?
I mean, Thiba Foundation was a charity that was established by the trustees of Islam Channel some time ago. Mostly the focus is education. Once we got into education, we found out there's loads of children who are physically handicapped, blind, disabled, which are the neglected children. I call them the special children of our society. Yeah. Especially in the UK, you see these children have got special privileges. They will have their own space. But if you go to a third world country, Pakistan, India, Sri Lanka, other countries that we walk in, Rwanda, these children are neglected. So this is a special night for these children where we'll be providing wheelchairs for them, education facilities for them. And our aim is to take you know, as much support from here, from UK, to these children and make their life better, basically.
Now, there's an event coming up, isn't there, on Saturday? Well, this coming Saturday.
This Saturday.
In London.
In Walthamstow Pavilion.
So that's happening this Saturday at the Pavilion Pavilion Banqueting Hall, is that right?
Yep, that's correct. Right.
It's called An Evening for Special Children, and it's a Thiba Foundation. And tickets are only £10 as well. So what can people expect at this event?
I mean, there's all the Islam Channel presenters are there, loads of them will be speaking about the project. There's also Nasheeds on the night. There's 3-course meal, as always.
Nice.
Inshallah. Hey, so, which is sponsored by the banqueting themselves. And it will be a night of entertainment. It will be a chance for everyone to meet the team from the Islam Channel. There's a lot of presenters coming down. And also look at what the projects that we are doing.
Inshallah. I urge everyone to come and support us, inshallah. And
inshallah.
Definitely. No, definitely. There's a meal going on there.
Exactly, yeah.
But smart. Tell us more about the Dawah Project and also a Muslim marriage event.
The Dawah Project is actually part of Islam Channel, so all the Islamic programs that come on TV, like the Hajj Live, Jumma Khutbah, they're all sponsored by the Dawah Project. At the same time, Dawah Project, we do events, various events for Islam Channel. We've got a marriage event coming up on Saturday, so...
Please, I think if you could do the honours, yeah. We've got a poster.
Most definitely, yeah. Again, this is also taking place at the Pavilion Banqueting Suite. Same venue, same day, but this is during the day. From 12 to 5, it's a Muslim marriage event.
Some very limited tickets are still available for that programme. It's a very highly popular
Pretty much
event.
Sold out, so inshallah, yeah, it's a good event.
What can people coming here expect as well? Because, I mean, marriage events are becoming more frequent, which is a good thing. Because there's so many young people in the community who want to get married and be in relationships and halal.
I mean, it's a very structured sort of event. I mean, it's not like any usual event that you go to. I mean, this is a structured event where we try our best to basically maximize the time that they are there for, to so that they can go ahead and find someone to get married.
The main aspect is for everyone to meet in a halal environment.
It's built in two segments. One first one will be like a roundtable rotation where we'll get a chance to meet everyone. Mm-hmm. And then the second element will be the one-to-ones. If there's anyone of interest, then the mahram and the families can meet, hopefully, inshallah.
But the mahram is obviously there as well.
Yes, of course. Highly encouraged.
Of course. Not just making sure everybody knows
it's
a completely halal environment, because I'm sure people will have questions. And one of the questions will no doubt be, how do people find out more if they want more information and B, buy tickets? How do they do it?
It's all on the Dawah Project social media, dawahproject.com, and also the Eventbrite, that we have got a page in there for the event this Saturday. I think there's a very, very limited tickets available. I think after your show tonight, it should get sold out, inshallah.
Inshallah. 75% there already, isn't it?
So, inshallah, we'll hope to see you all there on Saturday.
Fantastic. Two wonderful events back to back.
It's going to be a really good event, inshallah. I mean, the marriage event. I mean, there's a need in the society to for people to meet in a halal environment. So that's why Islam Channel Dawah Project, we're doing this event, inshallah, yeah.
Fantastic. Well, there's certainly great value there. It really is. And I think people are really going to benefit from this. It'll be a wonderful day. If you're there in the evening, you can meet several Islam Channel presenters as well. Loads of our colleagues will be there as well, inshallah. Guys, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Inshallah, the event will be a great success. And absolutely, as he says, keep up the good work, inshallah.
Thank you.
Well done. We're off for a break now, but before we go, we have another story. A Swiss ski instructor are also looking to strengthen bonds between themselves and fellow skiers in Iran.
Wow.
Let's take a look.
As a fierce blizzard sweeps mountains outside Tehran, a team of elite Swiss ski instructors refuses to allow the deep freeze to stand in the way of warming ties with Iran. Vincent Pillet and two other instructors were on a two-week mission, scouting for the best skiers in Iran to receive Swiss-style training and start up a new generation of instructors. Iran is not an obvious destination for ski aficionados. Fresh powder, bombing snowboarders and wild après-ski are not the first images that leap to mind when one thinks of the country. But the Alborz Mountains above Tehran are home to a clutch of excellent pistes, even if some of the pre-revolution facilities look somewhat dated. Skiing in Iran dates back around 80 years, when Germans arrived to dig coal mines in the mountains north of the capital and introduced locals to the sport. Resorts popped up and attracted international investors. At one point in the 1970s, a French-made cable car from northern Tehran was the longest in the world. When international business ties were rekindled by the 2015 nuclear deal between Tehran and world powers, easing sanctions on Iran, one Swiss firm spotted an opportunity. Andrea Gabus, who heads the investment company SGCH, believes that building a cadre of world-class instructors will attract more skiers and ultimately more business interest, while also strengthening ties between Switzerland and Iran.
what we're seeing in Europe is that we're really seeing it more and more as an elite sport. Iran, it is currently an elite sport, but there is a strong potential because of the closeness of Tehran to the ski resorts to really democratize this sport.
Gabus knows these are tricky times.
People taking an approach or an investment approach on this kind of industry, of course they might see short-term a little bit of blockage and a little bit of trouble, but the development inland of the infrastructure for winter sport is a very long-term process, and therefore taking an investment now does not mean dealing with the politics that we have right now. It means dealing with the politics that we're going to have in 25 years.
Up on the slopes, such concerns seem far away, despite some culture shocks for the ultra-organised Swiss. Andrea Gabus, who heads the investment company SGCH, believes that building a cadre of world-class instructors will attract more skiers and ultimately more business interest, while also strengthening ties between Switzerland and Iran. Coming up after the break, Fat Thursday is celebrated by people every year as part of a tradition. People indulge in fried donuts, also known as Paksky. Bakers in the country work overtime to cater to the lines of people waiting for their sugary treat. In Japan, a good number of retired elderly people are returning to the workforce. 7 million people from the older generation are working to earn money again and to help pay for their future care. Don't go anywhere. Living the life.
Winter is coming. Across the world, we are caring for thousands of orphans and refugees who urgently need winter survival kits. Without them, they could freeze to death. You can provide a winter survival kit for an orphan from just £30. Call 0121 446 5682 or go to islamichelp.org.uk. Let's keep them warm this winter. Donate now.
Muslim Charity and Islam Channel present the annual From UK with Love Pakistan Tour. Join us for an experience of a lifetime. Between the 26th of March to the 1st of April 2017, Muslim Charity will be taking supporters and friends on a 7-day tour of Pakistan to show how donations by UK donors are used to create impact on the lives of vulnerable communities. For further information and to download the information pack, please visit muslimcharity.org.uk or call us on 0207 100 4930.
Records presents Hamza Shuaib and his debut album Return to Allah, featuring his new single Road of Life. A to Z.
I, inshallah, will visit the city of Rasulullah.
And the title track, Return to Allah, available online and in stores now. Return to Allah.
Love, romance, intimacy, the essence of a marriage. Make those intimate nights perfect for your loved one with our exquisite lingerie and accessories. A halal lingerie website with no nudity, so there's no need to compromise on your faith. With our beautiful, affordable lingerie, make those intimate nights unforgettable. Order now on www.intimatenights.com. Intimate Nights.
There is great reward in building a mosque for Allah's sake. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, "Whoever builds a mosque for Allah, Allah will build for him likewise in paradise." Tibar Foundation's new initiative to build 99 mosques across Pakistan, Sri Lanka and Rwanda is already underway, but we need your continued and generous donations to help us complete this noble project. Each mosque will be named after one of the names of Allah and will help to serve the local communities in the poorest areas. Donate today by visiting tibarfoundation.org or call 020 7330 1744.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to Living the Life. Now, before we introduce our next guests, we have a very interesting story from Poland.
Poland!
Now, Fat Thursday, this is a real thing.
I'm going to say fat.
Fat Thursday.
Really?
It's just every Thursday for me. It's celebrated every year and it includes feasting on some fried donuts or an Atif special, as some people might call it. Anyway, it's a busy time of year for the bakers who are working overtime to meet the demands of not only me, but all of the Polish people. Let's take a look.
Out of the fryer, they're piping hot and there are boxes upon boxes of them. Every year on Fat Thursday, Poland goes crazy for ponczki, or fried donuts. It all goes back to a Catholic tradition, which has it that on the last Thursday of Carnival, just before the start of Lent, the faithful have the right to stuff themselves. These bakers are starting their 12th hour on the job, as shops nationwide battle to keep up with demand.
We got here at 10 last night, and by now I reckon we've cooked around 10,000 donuts.
Out on the street, the crowds of donut lovers continue to swell. The queue stretches for around 100 metres. The shivery weight in the Polish winter more than compensated by the prospect of a hearty dose of calories. That's the point of Fat Thursday.
My friend told me there's an hour-long wait, so I've only got half an hour to go and I'll be happy. I counted the queue when I got here and I'm number 66.
I bought 5 rose-flavored ones with almonds, 5 classic jam ones, 2 plain ones because my kids don't like jam, and 3 with advocate egg liquor for my colleagues.
Patience is a virtue and the reward is sweet. And because the donuts cost the equivalent of 60 euro cents, each customer snaps up around a dozen. For the bakery, that makes Fat Thursday one of the biggest money spinners of the year.
Today we're going to sell something like 30,000 donuts. That's 10 times more than normal.
Once bought, the donuts are generally wolfed down immediately. The national record holder can gobble up 10 in 5 minutes. Average Poles are a little kinder on their stomach, devouring a more reasonable 2.5 on Fat Thursday.
Good.
Oh, them donuts.
What's your favourite donut?
It's got to be the lemon one.
Oh, the lemon one. Okay, fair enough. I used to quite enjoy just a regular glazed donut, just a normal one that's been in the microwave for, let's say, 15 seconds. So it's a little bit warm, kind of, you know, like soft. It's kind of, I don't know, maybe it's the Asian.
Should we be honest?
Yeah.
Any donut in front of us.
Just no strawberry. I prefer custard in the strawberry, I'm going to tell you.
Anyway. Please welcome our next guest. The Middle East Business Leaders Awards are fast approaching and it is a fantastic event that will see business leaders interact with one another and to explore business opportunities. The event aims to recognise the achievements of inspirational leaders from across the sectors.
That's right. Now, here to tell us more, please welcome Shahul Hamid Daoud. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brother.
Jazakallah. Thank you so much for joining us, brother. It sounds like a fantastic event, the Middle East Business Leaders Awards. Tell us a little bit about how this idea came to you.
MashaAllah, I think it's my pleasure having, you know, being here. And you guys have been fantastic. You know, just listening to you for the last 15, 20 minutes has been fantastic.
Oh, that's very kind. Jazakallah.
Alhamdulillah.
This is the donuts.
We can talk very passionately about donuts, I can tell you that. Sorry.
Alhamdulillah. I mean, the Middle East Business Awards was started exactly 7 years ago. And we have been doing this in Abu Dhabi and Dubai, taking turns. The primary objective of this event is to bring all the business people, business community from the Muslim countries, and to do interact with, you know, all the top business people, young entrepreneurs. So at least they get to have a platform to source for new products and services. And it's, importantly, we believe that recognition is a very important factor for any business and the leaders. And when you get recognized, you get motivated and you have the extra factor to move along. And alhamdulillah, we've been doing this very successfully, and we are able to bring in a lot of young entrepreneurs around the world. And last year, we decided that we wanted to have a new venue, and we thought London will be a very important venue where we could bring in some, you know, GCC, you know, Middle East people, mm-hmm. and Malaysian people. We have people coming from Singapore, India. So this will be a meeting avenue for all these people along to interact with the business people in London. So that was the, you know, the whole thing we started last year earlier.
Fantastic. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely fantastic to see. It's now the seventh award, isn't it?
Yeah.
So obviously it's propelled to the beginning 7 years ago.
Yeah,
all of a sudden, obviously, people now, entrepreneurs now being recognised within the field. And
absolutely.
And obviously at these events, you're looking
at
the CEOs,
yeah,
you look at the owners, the vice presidents, and they're actually recognising all the young achievers that have come in, and it's just propelled now into its seventh year. I mean, that is absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, it's like you couldn't believe, you know, the time flies so fast, you know.
It does.
It's just like we started, you know. We started with a lot of tough things, you know. You know, it's never easy to start awards and run it, you know, internationally. It has a very good process and a system. You know, we don't just give awards to anyone and everyone. We accept nominations around the world. People send in their nominations, and they have a jury. A jury comes from almost 3 to 4 countries.
Mm-hmm.
They spend a lot of time sitting down, evaluating the nominations. And there's auditing firm. They need to make sure that they audit and authenticate the documents submitted by the award recipients.
It's
a whole lot of process involved in these awards. Yeah.
And it really is attention to detail as well. So a large organisation, they would recognise an individual.
Yeah.
That individual then they would then contact the organisation.
Yeah,
and then the organisation would do its own vetting, recognise that person, and then it go through a vetting system. And then on the night, it's when that individual will be awarded.
Yeah, in fact,
that's
right.
Fantastic.
Yeah, yeah.
Now, what kind of businesses do you look at in this? So are we talking about high-end, top-level businesses? Are we looking for dynamic new businesses? Mm. Are we looking for kind of SME organization? Like, what kind of businesses do we look for in this?
See, when we started initially 6 years ago or 7 years ago, our objective is to bring in the leaders, regardless of any sectors, regardless you come from SMEs or SMIs or, you know, large-scale companies. We want to pick the individuals. We know you want to get the drivers or the leaders who could really do well in the industry. Then over the period of time, it shaped up very well. Then we started to receive a lot of nominations from the large-scale companies. You won't believe it. The best boys in GCC have submitted the nominations for this Middle East Business Awards.
And
today we focus on 30 different categories, you know.
Wow.
30 different categories coming from
awards.
Yeah, 30 different categories from SMEs, SMIs, you know, the different sectors. Then we go for masterclass.
Mm-hmm.
Then we have lifetime achievement awards. So, you know, it's a whole lot of excitement for tomorrow.
I can imagine. Yeah. 30 awards.
Yeah.
That's right. It's such a broad range of sectors as well.
From exactly.
Some funding to business.
Yeah,
to
absolutely. We have things like, you know, automotive industry, aeronautic industry, you know, F&B. You know, we want to pick the best in that respective industry, and they need to be recognized. Yeah.
And there's a lovely book that you've done specifically for the awards, isn't
it? This we call it a coffee table book, and I know we printed and we circulated around the all top business people. Coffee table book, yeah. And we write a short in a description about the award recipient, where do they come from, what do they do, you know, what is their contribution to the community. In fact, we have the criteria for these awards, you know, they got to make sure, you know, they contribute back to the community, and they are social, CSR, corporate social responsibility is heavy, and they make sure they got employment opportunities for the young people. So these are all the criteria we put into
this. This is interesting. This is going to be my next question, actually, which is about what's the responsibility of an award winner? Because it's not just about self-celebration, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's about absorbing a responsibility.
Yeah.
Like, what do they give back?
You see, this is very, you know, interesting, you know, and you bring out this. We don't just leave the award recipient, they just come in, participate in the gala dinner, pick up the trophy and they go back. We need to make sure we keep the engagement going.
Mm-hmm.
We run a breakfast session with the leaders. We bring in young entrepreneurs, budding entrepreneurs.
Mm-hmm.
We sit down with them, they have a session with them, they share their success stories. And not everybody will be able to share their success stories tomorrow, but we will line up these people for the next 1 year. So, you know, we have a lot of content. And we have a lot of young people who are very keen to listen to these people. So we organize it over a tea or a breakfast or a dinner. So the excitement will be going on.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Now, how can people find out more and maybe purchase tickets for the event?
You see, most of these conferences and the top talks are done free. Uh-huh. You could go and register in the website, which is meblasa.com. Or you could register back in the American Leadership Development Association. That's one of the primary driver of this program. For young people, it's like a CSR. We want to do corporate social, for young uh-huh. people. They could at least listen to the experienced people, the seasoned people. So that could help them to have a, leapfrog strategy, from Absolutely. Zero. They just jump to 10, from the experience they gain from the those experts. Yeah.
And this event tomorrow is being held where?
It's held in Intercontinental Park Lane. Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah, it's going
that's
to be
nice
that's going to be 250 guests coming from almost 10 countries tomorrow. You get to see some of the best royalties, and we have some MPs coming from London as well.
Fantastic. And of course, we'll have Islam Channel's very own artist there as well, doing his thing as well. So if you're around and you want to get some business information, learn about business from the best in the world, it's a brilliant event to attend. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah, pleasure.
Stick around. We'll chat some more, inshallah.
Certainly, bro. Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity.
It's our pleasure to have you. Yeah. Inshallah, the event will be a great success.
Inshallah.
And continue on and on and on. Right now, we have to go for another break. But before the break, we will give you our customary story. And we are going to Japan.
Japan.
Now, the older generation are returning to work after taking retirement. There are now 7 million older people back at work. 7 million older people, can you imagine, to try and help boost the economy. Let's take a look as Japan goes to work.
Booming construction projects have destroyed many of the city's green spaces, leaving fans with few places to play. But hopes are growing that grassroots projects like a new FIFA academy will kickstart a revival of Myanmar's football scene and boost support for the national team.
I don't like how the Myanmar national team plays. They need a lot of work.
I hope that with time we will be successful now that there is more support for the game.
Myanmar's footballing heyday was in the 1960s and 70s when it was ranked among the best teams in Asia. But they faded as junta rule saw the economy disintegrate and the country's sporting infrastructure become neglected.
The country's economy needs to improve and the political situation should be stable. After that, sports can grow again.
Myanmar's Football Federation is scouting for talent in 52 cities to fill more than 200 places in its three academies, including at the FIFA facility in Yangon. Trainers from English Premier League clubs, including Arsenal and Everton, have also trained dozens of local coaches in a bid to raise standards.
Most international football federations can access very talented players easily. All they need to do is choose the best players to play for the country. But we at the MMF have to dig down to the grassroots.
But Myanmar is currently ranked outside the world's top 100. So the goal of recapturing its footballing glory days could well be some way off.
Coming up after the break, football used to be a popular sport in Myanmar, with its peak in the 1960s and 70s. Now sports authorities are launching projects to revive the football scene and get people back on the pitch. Stay tuned to find out more. Living the life.
Burgister Brothers. Extraordinary gourmet burgers. Now open in Piccadilly Circus.
Did you know that over 300,000 children die each year due to drinking unclean water? Clean water should be a basic human right, but so many people around the world lack this basic need. With your support, Tiba Foundation is working to end their suffering by providing water hand pumps and clean water systems around the globe. Donate now by visiting tibafoundation.org and help us save lives.
With millions lacking adequate shelter, heating, blankets, and even food, many will die from the cold this winter. Around the world, many face the prospect of a winter which could be their last. We're trying to change that. Don't let families face the winter alone. Keep them warm, keep them alive by donating at muslimhands.org.uk or call us today.
Doctors, professionals, community leaders, parents and grandparents, whichever role you're in, you want to get ahead and succeed in it. Oasis Crescent is the wealth manager that can manage your savings in an ethical, sustainable and Sharia-compliant manner. From as little as £100 per month or a one-off lump sum of £1,000, you can begin your journey to reach your financial goals. Contact Oasis today on 0808 238 7543 or visit oasiscrescent.com. Commitment unwavering.
The temperature is dropping. The nights are drawing in. How are you preparing to stay out of the cold? Sometimes it's easy for us to forget those for whom winter is a time of harshness, not comfort. Your hands may be cold, but your heart will stay warm if you allow the spirit of compassion to reach Palestinians in need. This winter, you can keep them out of the cold by coming together for Palestine.
Tiba Foundation, in association with Middlesex County Cricket Club, present a unique cricket tournament to be held at the Play On Sports Centre, London E1 2EG, on Sunday the 9th of April. Registration is just £50 per team and all proceeds will go to the Disabled Children's Project, which supports wheelchairs and education for physically disabled children in Pakistan and Sri Lanka. To take part, simply select up to six players and then register your team by calling 0207 330 1744 or email abdullah.khan@tibafoundation.org.
Assalamu alaikum and welcome back to Living the Life. And we're joined by some very special guests this evening. So stay tuned because we have more to come.
We most certainly do. Now, before we meet our final guests of the show, we have our last story of the show and of the week, of course, because it's the last show of the week. Oh. And now, we previously played you the story about football in Myanmar. We're now going to show you a story from Japan. As promised, let's take a look.
Retirement? Not for this 86-year-old. Teruo Sugiura spends 4 days a week in this workshop in Tokyo repairing traditional Japanese sliding doors.
There's no point staying at home, twiddling my thumbs. At least I'm happy working here, and I like the company.
Teru is one of some 7 million Japanese who've returned to work after retiring. With a shrinking and rapidly aging population, this silver-haired workforce is, for some analysts, a boon for the country's flagging economy.
You know, increasing number of active workers will be a driving force of economic growth in the supply side, and also growing number of active consumers will also be a driving force of economic growth in demand side.
And money is indeed the main reason many choose to return to work, with the average salary for pensioners like these around €300 a month. Taiko Mishima has been back in employment for 7 years. At 74, she's looking ahead, knowing that her pension will never be enough to pay for a nursing home.
It costs around 2,000 to 2,500 euros a month for full service. I can't do that with my pension, so I am putting money aside every month from what I earn here to plan ahead.
The government is gradually raising the retirement age to 65 by 2025. But even that would seem unlikely to deter Japan's geriatric working class.
I think there's a lot of value.
To get the exercises.
That's Tai Chi. But I like the idea of, you know, people sticking, because I think sometimes people undervalue what old people who are older are capable of, you know. Like my dad, mashallah, is in his early 80s now. And he can do things, mashallah. And I still can't do things that he can do now, you know. We'll go in the back garden, play a game of cricket. Mashallah, early 80s, he can still play with the best of them. So I think, you know, value the old people. They don't. It's not that they don't have skills. Use them, the resources.
Old is gold.
Most certainly.
Anyway, please welcome our final guests. We have two brothers from a very special initiative that works with people that memorise Qur'an. From workshops to imam placements, this organisation provides a wide range of services to support Hafizes in their development.
That's right. Now, we're very pleased to welcome Ishaq Jasad and Jamal Manan to the show. Assalamu alaikum, guys.
Wa alaikum salam, brother.
Jazakallah, thanks for joining us, guys. I'm very impressed with the way you guys have dressed up.
Thank you.
I think today we've had some of the best dressed people on the show.
Well,
from memory.
Okay.
So, do we win something for that?
Most just people have made an effort.
Just our love and our affection.
We like prizes.
Brothers, now, you guys started the National Huffadh Association UK. It's a beautiful project. I mean, you gave us some indication about, you know, imams getting placements and this kind of. Where did the idea, the inspiration for it come from?
It was actually around 4 or 5 years ago. Alhamdulillah, I memorized the Quran at a young age. And one thing I noticed was I was receiving a lot of messages from people through our placement. It just goes viral 2 or 3 weeks before Ramadan. And I experienced a lot of discomfort when I heard of friends who were Huffadh and they didn't receive any placements abroad. The core fact is that there are many masajids around the UK, but unfortunately, they're Huffadh outnumber all the time. So I had this venture in mind, and I thought, you know what, why can't I set up something to help, you know, the Huffadh? And alhamdulillah, it came about kind of last year. One of my cousins, he's one of our designers, and he launched the brand, and we just sort of hit up from there, alhamdulillah.
MashaAllah. Yeah. It's extraordinary that it's evolved over time to this, this project 5 years later.
Yeah.
How did you come to get involved with it, brother?
So, alhamdulillah, I'm related to brother Ishaq, and in my...
You guys are?
We're married to the same... sisters from the same family.
I see.
Alhamdulillah.
Yeah. But I thought I was going to say the same...
So,
I was going to make a dua there.
That's great. So you guys are related, and so who was there first, and who brought who on?
Well, he dragged me into it, really kicking and screaming, as with today, like, you know, mashallah, with 1 hour's notice. But alhamdulillah, you know, I've been very proud and privileged to be part of this. You know, as someone who is, you know, just interested in the education of my own children, as a layperson, if you like, that. There is such a big need for us to kind of match the tutors and the educating people in that sector to the needs of our children. And this is something, an organisation like this, that will not only just take those who have dedicated many years of their lives in kind of advancing and promoting the love of the Qur'an, and then to try and match them up with people who can, they, you know, can pass that on, that kind of knowledge on to. And we look after them, help them with their development, because a lot of the times, obviously, they've gone through that kind of course-specific focus around memorizing the Quran and the meaning sometimes. And then it's, in terms of putting that into practice, we feel that we can assist the Huffadh in doing that with their development, as well as, you know, meeting the needs of the communities, the wider communities, the dispersed, you know, Muslims around the UK.
This is more than just... This is also a mentoring project as well, because obviously you're very specific in terms of which imam goes to which pupil as well, because it's not just about the memorization of Quran, it's also life skills as well, isn't it? Social skills and the development of that person learning.
So, I mean, one of our core, the kind of bread and butter, if you like, of our organization, it started off initially to secure terrorist placements. So, basically, in Ramadan, as you know, many Huffadh, millions of Huffadh around the world, they lead the prayers. So, last year we had astonishing just over 1,200 applications. We only received around 150. Applications from masjids, which meant that the bulk of our Huffadh weren't received any placements as such. We actually sent 17 of them abroad. I think Germany, Switzerland, Jordan were 3 of them. So basically what we try to do is we try to instill core life learning skills. So as you know, one of the biggest needs at the moment for an imam is, for example, just of a Friday khutbah, how many of our imams actually speak in a language that relates to the actual audience? So, you know, we've consulted with Baba Numan Khan, many scholars around the world who just kind of give us that guidance as well. So we try to instill the wider social aspect of it. It's not just about memorizing, but what have you learned? You know, there's a hadith that comes to mind, the best of those people are those who Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, who read the Quran, teach the Quran, but also, you know, to promote the Quran. You know, so how much of it are we actually accessing? So we work with the Huffaz in that sense as well, you know, try to build their skills, try to build up the confidence as well. Because standing on that prayer mat, it's not easy, but moving forward, how do they go from there? So we try to do that as well.
Right. Of course, people learn in different ways. Yeah. There's this diaspora of expectation from people, because Western education, you know, it started to learn to cater for people with learning disabilities, yeah, and, you know, just like visual and cognitive, and people learn in different ways, basically. And just like that, the people who give out Islamic knowledge, they've kind of evolved their approach to get it. This is the benefit of a service like this, I imagine, that it gets so many of these guys out there to where the need is.
I mean, at the moment, just speaking to my brother-in-law, we've got over 10 WhatsApp groups with about 250 people in each group, and the name is just it's just called His Tips. And there's people that come to the group as parents, as professionals. Sure. There's one person who just contacted me a few days ago, who's a doctor who works in Canary Wharf. He said, look, I want to become a Hafiz, can I join one of your groups? So it's not just for someone who's religious, so to speak, or someone who goes, who's on the deen. You know, it's for everyone, you know. Subhanallah, the Quran is made easy for all of us to memorize. So we try to cater for everyone. And, you know, alhamdulillah, you know, we pride ourselves in the sense that we don't discriminate. You know, we try to reach out to as many people as possible in that sense.
That's fantastic. And
Where are you actually situated? Where are you based?
At the moment, this is one of partly why we're kind of branching out. And alhamdulillah, like, just by word of mouth, just by various WhatsApp groups, it has gone viral. Last year, with minimal amount of marketing, alhamdulillah, you know, there's 1,200 kind of members or Huffaz members we have on our database. Yeah. We have we made over 182 placements in the masajids across the UK. As Isaac, brother Isaac said, 17 of them abroad. So that just shows, without much kind of outreach work, the kind of the thirst, the need for this kind of service, which, alhamdulillah, you know, our intention is to become the go-to people for kind of go-to organization to try and get parents and families and communities and organizations and businesses to match them with the kind of the person they're looking for that Islamic knowledge.
Fantastic.
And, you know, just please, and the variety is like, even we're getting emails from people like from Canary Wharf and businesses there who are saying, look, we want our people to run our Jummas, we've got Taraweeh placements, we've got facilities, but we don't have people. So the need is there,
absolutely. Now, I'm sure there's people out there that are watching right now thinking, we need to find out more about this, want to get involved, just learn more. How do they find out more? How do they get in touch?
So we've got our website. Alhamdulillah, we've got an event coming up on the 16th of April, which is our first official memorization Quran competition, alhamdulillah. We're going to have Sheikh Abubakar Shatri, Mufti Menk, he's one of our advisors as well, alhamdulillah. Qari Ziyad from South Africa, he's our main amir. So basically, we did literally, coincidentally, just 2 hours ago, we just finalised the poster. So if you go onto our website, ukhuffadh.org/competition, so ukhuffadh.org/competition, there's three categories, 0 to 10 Jews, 11 to 20 Jews, and those people that want to enter, who memorise the entire Quran, it's open to anyone in the UK, any age. And alhamdulillah, so that's something we're trying to promote. The grand final is going to be held in London, Edmonton Mosque, on the 16th of April. We will have a lot of attendees for that, and we have three regional rounds. So basically, it's a kind of way to promote our organisation, at the same time, get people on board as well. And it's our first main Quran competition event as well.
Fantastic. Listen, that's fantastic work you guys are doing. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make you guys successful. Make us grow and grow. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you so much to our brother. Thank you for having us. Pleasure. And thank you to all of our guests as well for being here. You guys all have wonderful initiatives. It's just been a really fun show today.
Inshallah, everybody watching
will take something away from today's show. Inshallah.
So, unfortunately, we're out of time, but a big, massive thank you to all our guests, and especially you guys watching at home.
That's right. Now, you can stay with us on Twitter at Islam Channel using the hashtag LTL. Plus, don't forget, you can watch your favorite clips again via our website and on YouTube at youtube.com/IslamChannelTV.
That's right. Living the Life will be back live on Monday at 7 p.m. Tune in on to Saturday at 7 p.m. to catch up on all the best bits of this week's show. But until then, Asalaamu Alaikum.
That was good.
Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "A woman is married for four things: her wealth, her status, her beauty, and her religion. So you should marry the religious woman, otherwise you will be from amongst the losers.
Indonesia, the world's largest Muslim nation. Despite boasting over a quarter of a billion followers, to many, the country's Islamic history is unknown. Join me on Asia Wired as I explore Islam's journey to Indonesia, how it spread, and its influence today.
The arrival of Islam in that area was relatively late. And another distinct feature is that the introduction was peaceful.
Tune in to Pick of the Week for your weekly fix of Islam Channel highlights every Sunday at 4:30 p.m. only on Islam Channel.
Women's AM is now on the road. First up, Walthamstow Pavilion in London this Saturday, the 18th of February. Doors open at 3 p.m. We'll be discussing the issue of misogyny and whether we women are our own enemies. We'll also cover how to be confidently Muslim, as well as entertainment by poets Shaheena Khatun and Hodan Yusuf. To register, email us at wamontheroad@islamchannel.tv.
Compelling Records presents Hamza Shuaib and his debut album, Return to Allah, featuring his new single, Road of Life. A to Z.
I, inshallah, will visit the city of Rasulullah.
And the title track, Return to Allah, available online and in stores now. Return to Allah.
Winter is coming. Across the world, we are caring for thousands of orphans and refugees who urgently need winter survival kits. Without them, they could freeze to death. You can provide a winter survival kit for an orphan from just £30. Call 0121 446 5682 or go to islamichelp.org.uk. Let's keep them warm this winter. Donate now.
Burgister Brothers. Extraordinary gourmet burgers. Now open in Piccadilly Circus.
Are you ready for this winter? Turning up the thermostat, running a warm bath, pouring yourself a hot drink. We're all ready for winter. Unfortunately, others are not. Thousands of orphans need your help to survive the winter. Your donation will provide an orphan with a warm winter coat, a hat, a scarf, gloves and winter shoes. Call 03000 121 121 to donate £30 now.
Love, romance, intimacy, the essence of a marriage. Make those intimate nights perfect for your loved one with our exquisite lingerie and accessories. A halal lingerie website with no nudity, so there's no need to compromise on your faith. With our beautiful, affordable lingerie, make those intimate nights unforgettable. Order now on www.intimatenights.com. Intimate Nights.
There is great reward in building a mosque for Allah's sake. The Prophet, peace be upon him, said, "Whoever builds a mosque for Allah, Allah will build for him likewise in paradise." T-Bar Foundation's new initiative to build 99 mosques across Pakistan, Sri Lanka and Rwanda is already underway, but we need your continued and generous donations to help us complete